Okay, so remain in him. To remain in him is just like Romans chapter 6 verse 2 says, how shall we that have died to the sin continue therein anymore? How shall we continue in the sin? You know, those of us that have died to the sin. Even if we just get a little glimpse of the knowledge and we believe, we make that decision to believe. Yeah, and we never grow. We just stay a baby all of our lives, right? You know, a baby doesn't grow. He's not confident. He's not sure in himself, right? And he thinks that if he commits all these sins and stuff, like, he's thinking, oh, I'm just not good enough because I keep committing these sins, right? So he's tossed to and fro. And he feels so guilty. That's why it's important to grow. That's why it's important to keep ourselves under a teacher that's going to teach us, right? Till we can be mature and foundated, so that we don't need no more teaching, like we read in the other book we read, Ephesians, or maybe even 1 John said that. Probably Ephesians, right? He says, I need not to teach you anymore. Wherever it said that, I'll have to find that. I think it's important that we find that. Where did I see that? Let me go to Ephesians. James. Gentiles eat pork chops. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. Gentiles eat pork chops. No, it has to be 1 John. Okay? Because the Ephesians were shaken. They were shaken in their faith, and Paul had to write them. So don't be shaken that I'm in jail. But John says, John's the one that said this, that you need not anyone to teach you. Yeah, he says, you are strong, young men, you are strong. Okay, now where did I see that part? Okay, the world does not pass away, da 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 da. Playing the anointing, da da da. Truth, liar, da da da. Denying, heard from the beginning, remain in you. I promise, I write these things concerning you, those leading you astray, and you did receive, remain in you. Oh, here it is, verse 27, chapter 2. And you, the anointing that you did receive from him, the anointing. Remember the anointing in James? He says, anoint the sick with oil, or the weak, those that are placing themselves under the heavy burden of the law. They're weak. He says, anoint them with oil. It's not anoint them with Crisco oil and say a little prayer. Bull pucky. He says, tell them the truth about the sin. That's anointing them with oil. And you, the anointing that you did receive from him. That's why I say, that's why I don't say Jesus Christ. It's Yeshua, the anointed one. The one who provides us the anointing oil. Okay. He says, and you, the anointing that you did receive from him, it does remain in you. Why? Because you died to the sin. How shall you continue in it anymore? Paul says in Romans chapter 6, verse 2. All right. I need to put a little note on that. That little note on that too. Remain equals died to the sin. Right? Romans 6:2. Okay, remain. Okay, he says, and you, the anointing that you did receive from him. Alright? We receive the truth from him. We don't have our own testament. We don't look within ourselves for the truth. We learn it from him. We accept it within our heart. We make that decision. All right, our emotions are evoked. We can't obey the law. The thinking process gets us to think, oh, and then the thinking connects with the heart, and the heart makes the decision. The decision, it's his decision. It's his gospel. It's not ours. It's not our testament. It's our decision. All right, but even our decision is what he lives in us. He's the one that made us make the decision. He found it. He knew us from the very foundation before the world. He created us to make that decision. Vessels of honor. And then he made vessels for destruction to go to hell. Okay. So that we could know his judgment. And make his judgment known. Okay. And you, the anointing that you did receive from him, it does remain in you. And you have no need that anyone may teach you. But as the same anointing does teach you concerning all and is true and is not a lie. Okay. Now what he's talking about here is you don't need anyone to teach you. Okay. He's saying once you're growing and you know you're going through your growth period, right? You have the Holy Spirit. Right? The Holy Spirit confirms everything. And it's the Holy Spirit that puts the final clincher on it. Right? We listen to a man speak and we're like, oh, wow. And then the Holy Spirit that lives in us agrees with it. Says, yep, that's right. And then we say, oh, yeah, it is right. Wow, yeah. We have no need that anyone teach us. That's what he's talking about. You know, and then at the same time, you know, once we become mature, right, you know, you know, we're able to teach now. We can teach it. We can tell the world. We can tell people about it. We can explain it to them. And we should be gentle in our explanations, right? Right. We want to be loving. Okay. Okay, so anyway, chapter 3, left off around verse 5, okay. And you have known that he may take away our sins, and sin is not in him. Everyone who is remaining in him does not sin. Everyone who is sinning has not seen him or known him. Okay? He's not talking about everyone that's sinning. Okay? That's why the church is always pounding on everybody. We must live holy lives. We have to live holy lives because they think that he's talking about the sin nature. Right? And they're always telling everybody in the pulpit, quit doing this and quit doing that. Quit doing this and quit doing that. And if you're doing this, raise your hand and confess it. Come up before us and the elders. Come up to the altar, our altar of Satan, and let us pray for you. Yeah, let us keep the curse on you. What they're really doing, right? So it's the sin. He who is sinning, in other words, he who is participating in the sin, has not seen him or known him, right? He who is participating in the sin has been deceived. They think they're doing right. Ah, I'm doing right. I'm living a good life. I'm helping everybody I can. And I'm looking good in the community, in my church, at the workplace, at the bank, at the credit union, or down by the real estate office, and everything. I'm in the CIC groups. I'm day for V and everything, and this, and that, everything. That has nothing to do with eternal life. All right. Okay. Everyone who is remaining in him does not sin. Everyone who is sinning has not seen him or known him. Little children, let no one lead you astray. He who is doing the righteousness is righteous. Now he's giving a little reminder to the little children. Little children, okay, little children. They're easily formed and manipulated, right? So he's saying, don't let anyone lead you astray, little children. What's he say about the little children over here? He says, Father says, I write to you, verse 12, chapter 2, I write to you, little children, because the sins have been forgiven you through his name. He doesn't tell the little children that they are strong, like the young men. Verse 14, I did write unto you, young men, because ye are strong. He didn't tell the little children they're strong. That's why he says over here, little children, let no one lead you astray. All right. What's another description of a little child? A little baby Christian, just first coming to the truth. All right? Don't let anyone lead you astray. Okay. He who is doing the righteousness, the definite article, the righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. Everyone is doing a specific righteousness, and it's all centered around the knowledge of the sin. Trying to be like the Most High is the sin. Okay, verse 8. He who is doing the sin. Okay, look at that. We have another real clear one right there. He who is doing the sin. Another real clear picture. He who is doing the sin is of the devil. Because the devil did the sin from the beginning. It just says sin here. Okay, but we know it's the sin. Because the devil did the sin from the beginning. He who is doing, right. Now John is telling us exactly what Satan did right from the get-go. The sin. Right from the get-go. So if we're ever wondering, now where's the talk about that Satan did the sin? Yeah, right from the get-go. Right here. This gives us another little clue. Right from the beginning. Okay. Devil committed the sin at the beginning. Yeah, I had me a little spark plug wire there. Keep it running. Combustion chamber going. Firing well. All right. So when I open up my scripture, I can instantly see it and be reminded. Instead of having to look at a bunch of print, and I don't have it reminded yet, and it's all just overwhelming to me. I have my private little notes here. Keep me energized. Okay. The Son of the Most High was made known for this, that he may break up the works of the devil. What are the works of the devil? He committed the sin. He tricked Eve into committing the sin. Adam willfully committed the sin. Adam and Eve's children, who later became known as the Israelites, committed the affirmed their condition of the sin by voluntarily putting themselves under the law of Moses. The Most High came to give them that law as a test. He was testing them to see if they would remember that they were brought out from Egypt by the blood that they wiped across their doorpost before the night that they were going to leave Egypt. Moses said, slay an animal, put the blood on the doorpost. So when the death angel comes over to kill the firstborn of all Egypt, right? He'll pass over. He'll see the blood and he'll pass over us. He'll pass over you. That blood was supposed to give them a reminder and a hint, right, of what they were supposed to put their hope in, right? Their hope is not in the commandment. Because Adam and Eve, I bet you bottom dollar, Adam and Eve damn well made sure that their children knew that the commandment of the Most High couldn't be performed. I can bet you my bottom dollar. And then as time progressed, the generations forget. That's just the condition of